church every Sunday. Online, I am the sanctuary. Receiving a word from the Lord to uplift my spirits. But what I really need to know is how to make it through the week. I need to know how to handle it. Someone please help me.
Church,
what's really going on?
Church,
Monday to Sunday morning.
Church,
benediction is said. Please keep it real with me.
Church,
don't worry, don't fret. We found an outlet.
We're
gonna keep it real with you.
P. Riley and Lady Reed.
After church.
After church. With P. Rod and Lady Reed.
Yo, what's up? It's P. Rod. I'm here with my wife, Lady Marie. This is After Church. This is the quarantine edition. It's been a while since we came to talk to you, but we decided that we'll pick it back up. We're kind of sort of trying to ease our way back into some normalcy with all of this going on. But before I go further, let me let Lady Marie holler at y'all real quick.
Hello, everyone. Been missing you. Glad to be here. Let's talk.
Yeah, let's do that. We want to keep it 100. That's the whole theme. This is really about not so much as what's happening in church, but life and living after church, not just for us, but for everybody. And so there's some subjects we may not talk about in the pulpit, but we want to talk about a little bit here to give you just kind of where we are on everything. One of the things, especially in this moment that we're living in, is I want to kind of just give you some insight into the mental challenges that have been that we've dealt with during this moment. Lady Marie, being the homemaker in this kind of situation for the last almost year and a half, where we've been limited in so many different things, what's been the mental challenges of making it happen and maintaining? I know we've been physically limited with certain things we're not able to do,
right?
But how does it make your job more difficult? Has there been anything happening in you just mentally that you had to kind of hold yourself together in this moment? What's going on with that with you?
I think the main thing I have has been just being in the four walls. Didn't realize how much it meant to just know that you can get outside, whether you go outside every day or not literally outside the house, but outside of town, outside of just having the choices to go wherever you want at any moment of the day. And sometimes we like to do that. But when you have laws and different things in place that just keeps you or says to you that you cannot go anywhere, you got to just basically stay home as much. When we were in the run of the day and it wasn't a law or anything that you had to abide by, you wanted to be home. I mean, that was just, whoo, I can't wait till I get home. But when someone tells you you have to be home, it's a different mindset. And that's been the greatest thing to know that, I mean, my family, we could just say, let's go just to take a break, change of scenery. Yeah. Let's go to Orlando or let's go here. Let's go get us something to eat because we want to eat something different. And then you think about it. Oh, can't do that. Let's figure out what we're going to do to keep that, just to keep the change of pace. What could we do differently within the four walls? So the main thing as the manager of the home is, how can I bring in maybe a meal, or how can I change the scenery within my home to make everybody stay on the uptick and keep things going and know that, you know, even though it seems bad on the outside, we're still good.
Well, let me ask you this. Since we're on that subject matter, the children, the sacrifices they made mentally, that challenged you yourself. I know it's a mental challenge for our kids because they made some adjustments for us. But how does it make you feel in this moment, thinking that I know how I feel? You know, there are certain things in their last couple of years they didn't get or would not get from the school setting itself because there's so many things going on. And their sacrifices, but how did that affect you with the decisions we had to make or were trying to make? And why did you make the decision, you know, when we talked about it, that I think we want to keep them home and move forward? How difficult was that, especially with him being in his senior year?
Right. This is brand new territory we've never treaded before. So to have to make choices for our kid, well, we didn't make the choice for our kids, but we came together as a family and we just put all the cards on the table and all the liabilities and the pluses and the minuses and came to some decisions that were very hard. To be honest, I cried, especially with my son going into his senior year. He was a pretty much a star basketball player. So we knew he was going to start. He was going to be, you know, pretty much getting his name out there in the last year like it normally happens when you're a senior. And for him to make the choice, thinking about his family and the best choice for all of us to say, I opt out, I'll just stay inside with everybody else, and I won't even darken the door of the school in my senior year or play basketball. That was, I know it was hard for him, but that was really hard for me as a parent, because you always want to feel like you're in control. And if it's something that your kids need or some rescue you could come to change whatever the whatever it is, you want to be able to do that. But as a parent, and this time, things were out of my hands, out of his dad's hands, and we just had to go with what was there in front of us, and that wasn't a comfortable place.
Well, I already know it was challenging for me, so it's been a lot. We're supposed to be playing this game, so let me go ahead and move on to the next question, and I'm open for you. What do you want to ask me?
Also, same question. In these times, what mental challenge you had as the head of the household, the father, watching, trying to keep me up, trying to keep the children up, just the management of all of that mentally and the church? What mental challenges have you had in dealing with everything in this pandemic?
Well, it's been very interesting, very interesting. I came into a realization that, and it hadn't been too terribly long ago, because sometimes when you get beyond a situation, you start to reflect on the situation and you start to realize, okay, so this has affected me more than I thought. And you know, I never want to belittle mental health or anything like that, but it's never been something that has been in the forefront of my mind.
Right.
Because, I mean, you know, we were brought up certain types of ways.
Yes.
But I begin to realize, you know, this has been tough. This has been really tough. I consider myself a breadwinner. I consider myself a provider. I'm a multifaceted kind of person, and so it's been hard. First, the sacrifice that my family had to make. Let me back all the way up. We were literally getting ready to go on a vacation within a couple of days when everything really shut down over a year and a half ago. And all of a sudden, you know, you realize that the world has completely changed. And see, I'm this guy who rolls. I'm a crisis dude. They know it. I call it crisis mode. That means that when something happens, something goes wrong, you know, I'm just kind of just like, okay, we got to get through it. So I put my head down. We start working. We start making things happen. When we do that, then all of a sudden, you know, you kind of move into that mode. And for actually over a year, almost 2 years now, I've been in that mode. But I hadn't realized the effects that it has had, not just being a father or the homemaker or the provider for the home, taking care of my daughter, making sure that they're mentally strong, making sure that the sacrifices that they made, they were included in the decisions and all that we do. But at the same time, recognizing that a lot of their decisions, I want you to listen to me, was difficult because their decisions really, really related a lot to me. You look at me now, you recognize and I understand who I am, what my lifestyle has been like. And so there's a number of things that I had to deal with, challenges health-wise throughout my life. And so the decisions that were being made, man, they were making decisions because of the love that they had in them. And I was appreciative of it, but it bothered me to a great degree because those decisions were made that kind of limited them in things that they were doing and that kind of thing. And so I felt like, man, I'm robbing them. I'm taking some things. That was very difficult. And then at the same time, I'm pastoring and recognizing that all of a sudden we've had a certain normal for so long, and we've been able to go to church and minister to people and talk to people and deal with people. And now you're asking or you're dealing with people and you have to communicate with them and try to get them to understand that the best move for us at this moment is here. And I thank God for Family Worship Center and all of those who are there, because it was so supportive and are so supportive in the decisions. And it's so many things that have happened. But at the same time, on the backside of it, I'm struggling because there are things that I know you need, know that I'm used to doing that I'm unable to do. There's this battle. This is the biggest battle of them all. Weighing the entirety of the situation, weighing not just myself, weighing my parents, my kids, everything connected to me, because really this virus is really not about a personal decision. It is really about the responsibility that we have to of the people. And so I had to decide, you know, I gotta be alive for my family. I gotta make sure that I'm here. And so there's some tough decisions, because that while other people may not be dealing with what you're dealing with, and especially as me as a pastor, all of a sudden, and that's why I pray for pastors, and I understand, and a lot of people don't understand the burden that comes with the moment, because you don't want to disappoint people. You want to continue to be able to minister to them, to do what God has called you to do. But at the same time, there is a real crisis that is going on that is not, it's spiritual, but there's some physicality that comes with it. So those choices of, okay, this is not a moment where we should be together. This is a moment where we gotta recluse. And so that began to challenge me.
It's how to make it through the week. I need to know how to handle it. Someone please help me.
Church.
What's really going on?
Church.
Monday to Sunday morning.
Church.
Benediction is said. Please keep it real with me.
Church.
Don't worry, don't fret.
Church.
I think we found an outlet.
Church.
I'm gonna keep it real with you.
P. Riley and Lady Reed.
Church with
the innovations of making sure that we can stream and that we can communicate and then talk to people on a regular basis to encourage, to keep them up, to keep them strong in the same situation while you're feeling helpless yourself. And the biggest part of that, as I move forward, the biggest part of that is when you're in crisis mode, and that's who I am. When I'm in crisis mode, everything in me doesn't think about that. It doesn't deal with that. We don't even go with that. But it, recognizing in crisis mode while I'm going through that, but there is mental things that are happening to me that I'm flushing away. I'm not dealing with.
Yes.
I'm feeling low at moments, but I'm not dealing with them because I'm trying to be strong for my family, for everything connected to me. And so as we move out, and we're not out of the pandemic, but as we move through it, I begin to realize that the stress and strains of these moments have really affected me. They actually helped me, not in a sense where I'm low and I'm crazy or something of that nature, but those pressures come with that, and that's something that I had to realize that I had to learn how to take a break. I had to learn how to decide, okay, I can't do everything. Everybody's gonna be okay. We got to keep working. We got to keep doing. But I know you're trying to carry the burdens of everybody, and they're praying for you, but you don't want to show any weaknesses. But the weakness is real, real simple. It's easy to show weakness to people who expect you to be weak, but it's not easy to show weakness to your wife that you've always been strong to, to your kids that you've always been strong to the members and the people in the ministry that you've ministered, that they call you for prayer. They call you for uplifting.
Yes.
And so it began to challenge, like, where do you go, Rod? Where do you go? I wasn't in a place. So what I did was buried myself in work. And then I realized later, looking down the road, and there's so many other areas about this we could talk about. I looked down the road and realized, man, you've been affected because it's been a lot. I had my brother tell me not long ago. He said, but you just got to learn to schedule breaks. Because in this moment, the world has changed and there's so many people who are dependent upon you, but you can't be always there if you've never let yourself take a break.
Right.
And so those are some of the things that I dealt with personally, and they've been challenging. Oh, wow, has there been challenges with deaths and decisions I've had to make about what I could do and where I could go. But those decisions were made because I love you. I love them. My first ministry is to God and to my family. And I want to make sure that my parents are good and that I'm good. And so there's certain things that would have been traditional to do that I just simply couldn't do because of the things that I know about me and the things that I couldn't afford to be challenged with and to bring back to people and to watch somebody be affected by my decisions. So I had to make tough decisions. And that has been a challenge. That has been a challenge. This is your move.
Yes. Try to block this. Let's see.
It ain't nothing to block.
Let me go right here.
Okay. Well, I want to ask you this. Mm-hmm. When you consider everybody around you, and when you consider the vaccine, because that's the controversy, you know, the world is dealing with right now. Just personally, not even our conversation together.
Okay.
And we don't have a whole lot of time because we don't want to be too long. What were the considerations you that went into your decision to be vaccinated?
Well, a lot of my education came from you because you were doing the research, you was doing the homework, you was making sure, which I loved about Pastor and my husband, is that he kept us informed throughout this whole process and still informing us of different changes and what's going on. So through the information I was getting, we talked about it. And I had come to myself at the beginning or at the just before we got ready to take the vaccine. And I came to Pastor Rod, as you know him,
I'm Rod at the church, man. I told him, I said,
Rod, you know, when I think about this, it's just like anything else that's coming to the world. Any kind of disease that we, that America has had to deal with, we had to get a vaccine for. We had to get a shot for, and we call it immunization. But this is called a vaccine. I began to think about it like that, and I said, okay, this is something that's entering into our country, and we have to get our immunization system or our immune system up to the level it needs to be to fight it. So why not? Let's do it. And if it's going to, through all the education, we watch clips of just different people and doctors that had educated themselves on how, what the effects of the vaccine would have. It just was like, I'd rather be on this end of it. So let me get it. I had to get one for polio, chicken pox, measles, yep, all of that. So yep, why not this?
Well, I'll go straight at mine. I remember when this thing happened. Yeah, I don't know if you all remember. Some of you who are a part of us remember. I know my family, and I would talk to people who were connected to us. It was like, because my son was supposed to play basketball that year, coming into it or whatever. And my whole thing was, when we first heard about it, that by the time we moved to time for ball, that there would be a vaccine that would become available so that we wouldn't miss anything, not knowing the severity of it. I had done a lot of work, you yeah know, a lot of homework, because I don't do things, you know, just haphazardly. I want to make sure that it's healthy for us or that it's okay for us.
Right.
I trust God in the whole thing. And that's why I'm telling you the after church part of it. Of course we pray, of course, but there are certain things you have to think about. And so I thought about all that stuff and I was like, you know what? Here's where I am with it. We pray for a vaccine, man. And then all of a sudden, there's one available. And I know about the age of it, and I know about all of the things that have been brought up and the potential of former things that have happened and things that happened in the body and all of that kind of stuff. But what I did pray about it. But what release I had is I did all of the homework I knew to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was talking to actually a member of our church. And this was deep because we had talked about it, and I think his wife had, and he was talking about getting it. And he said, man, this where I am, bro. He said, I don't know what's in Tylenol. I don't know what's in this medicine.
Right.
We had to have vaccines this whole time.
Yeah.
He said, I trust God then. I'm going to have to trust him now. And it resonated with me, mm-hmm, so much. Because at this point, we had to come to a place where we decided we're going to trust God.
That's it.
And I know the people's opinions. And I know what you would initially think. And I'm never here to debate and say that you should do or not.
That's
do
it.
But we came to a personal decision,
yep,
that, you know what? My parents are in their 80s. I have issues. Your mother's in her 70s. All of our family is we're a very close-knit family, so we always want to be together. We always want to hang out, but this is a dangerous moment, and it's not recommended. And so I said to myself, I said, well, here's the deal. Especially when my parents had chosen to go and make that move, I'm like, I can't keep coming around them and be around them.
That's
and
it.
Not protect them, not protect all of us. And so I said, okay, this is what we're going to do, man. We're just going to move in it. If you with it, we're going to go get it. And we're going to trust and believe God. I mean, I know there could be effects or whatever, but that's where we are. But that was still another challenge.
Because
church, you should know this very well. I've never imposed upon you what you should do. I've specifically told you, this is what we did. This is why we did it. A number of you called me privately. A number of you heard me just talking about it openly. This is why we did it. This was the effect. I remember talking to one of my members that was a part of the board, and I told them what I was getting ready to do. And the person said to me, she said, are you going to be willing to tell us everything that happened with the response and reaction to it? And I was like, by all means. I said, as soon as I get it, I'm going to show you the picture. I'm going to tell you what I go through, whether there's a side effect, the types of side effects. I'm going to be as candid as Pastor Rod always is. I'm P. Rod. I keep it a buck. I'm going to keep it 100. So I'm going to tell you what's going on. And in the midst of that, I just decided, okay, I'm going to be open and transparent. But one of the things that challenged me was I was reluctant to even be that transparent because I didn't want to send the message that you should do this or you should not do this. I was telling you what the decision was that I made and giving people insight into who and what I am, because I'm not trying to hide anything. And so that was important to me, but it was still a mental challenge. And I don't know if you're catching this, but I'm getting ready to move to one more thing. We're going to get out of here. I don't know if you're catching this, but this whole thing is really this quarantine edition. Just the first, this it's really, we're talking about this mental health thing. and the effects and things that we deal with physically, not just us, but many people. The Bible says, I will keep you in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him. And sometimes there's so many things going on, and that sounds so spiritual and so deep, but there's so many things, toxic church. The phone calls we got during this time, the different, trying to find groceries, trying to make sure that our children were taken care of.
Not seeing your family and trying to make sure they're okay through a phone call. Yeah. I mean, because, you know, they may have gone out, you may have gone out, and you want to touch them, your mom, your sister, and you couldn't because my sister's, you know, who she is, being a public worker, and my mom, you know, you're just trying to make sure everybody's okay and not being able to see them. That was quite a challenge.
And let me bring it home because we're getting ready to go because we got a couple of games we got to watch. Remember the Lakers play in just a little bit. So you can't beat me, girl. I don't know what's wrong with you. You can't beat this. I'm that guy. Listen, here's where we sit though. At the end of this whole thing, it has been such a challenge with the ministry in itself. Man, ministry is so important to us. And we were so not necessarily thinking that we would lose anyone, but as a pastor, wanting to make sure that people stay strong, wanting to keep them confident and keep them pushed and positive in the dark moments that were around. And so when you sometimes going through all the darkness and you're like saying to yourself, man, what's really going on? You know what I mean? You saying to yourself, what's really going on? Is it your go?
No, I just
went. You sure?
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's get out of here.
Oh, man.
But with all that stuff going on, it was like, okay, so what we going to do, man? I got to keep you good. At the end of the day, we came to this place. I came to this place. And I know for those many of you who may have mental issues and things that you deal with and just the challenges of life, and you really don't want to tell anybody of what you're dealing with, I'm that guy. I don't tell anybody either, but what I'm trying to do is keep it 100, and that's what this is all about. We decided to come back into after church, and we're going to be very, very consistent with it, try to make it a very, very interesting thing, not just this communication, playing games, and so on and so forth, but all of that. But to say to you, there's life after church. God is a keeper. God takes care of us, and we have to trust him in whatever we do.
That's right.
But it still doesn't mean that we have bills. Did you see how people were losing jobs? Money was drying up. It was so many things. I mean, yes, there were stimulus checks, all that stuff going on.
And
but
racial.
It's a part of life. And even in this moment, it's still a part of life. We deal with things outside of the doors of church. And if we never, ever talk about those things and give you insight into really the feelings and emotions that we have, Jesus said, you don't have any feelings or infirmities that I'm not connected to. We're trying to make sure that we do exactly what you said.
That's
real
right.
talk. We want to talk about it. We come into how our relationship was affected, how the relationship with other family members, who was drawn in, who was not. So many different things. And then we want to get into just an overall situation. We're going to have some things for some kids, too. We're getting ready to get out of here because the Lakers getting ready to go. Yep, Bron and Westbrook starting tonight, so we're going to go get this. But this has been great, just communicating. I hope you enjoy after church. It's going to get better and better. I promise you, this time we have a lot planned. We're going to be very, very candid, talk about so many different things. We're going to try to stay as clean as possible. But what you're going to get from Pastor Ryan, what's your name?
You later read.
What you're going to get is we're going to keep it a buck. We're going to keep it 100. We're so glad to have you. That's what time it is. Going to have a kiss on the way out? After church, we gonna get busy.
Church every Sunday, online or in the sanctuary. Receiving the word from the Lord to uplift my spirits. But what I really need to know is how to make it through the week. I need to know how to handle it. Someone please help me.
Church.
What's really going on?
Church.
Monday to Sunday morning.
Church.
Benediction is said. Please keep it real with me.
Church.
Don't worry, don't fret. I think we found an outlet.
Church.
I'm gonna keep it real with you.
P. Riley and Lady Reed.
After church with P. Rod and Lady Reed.